What would big multinationals come to Mozambique for? Well, resources, isn't it? Yeah? And the first, if you do remember, the first wave of attempts to attract big capital in Mozambique were related to the Green Revolution. And in particular, with biofuels. And the Green Revolution was not focused in producing food for the domestic market. It was focused in producing a big agro-business sector for the world economy. Now, the Green Revolution thing didn't work very well. Actually, it was quite chaotic. But above all the effort the government put in place in order to develop a biofuel strategy came to an end in 2007-2008 with the international crisis that made resources not available. And also in Europe, there was a debate about biofuels not being that clean in any case. So the interest in biofuels collapsed. So what was the next thing to do? The next thing to do was to put available the other resources of the country, naturally gas and minerals. Some people say we found gas in 2010. That's not true at all. Samora Machel, Mário Machungo, and others in Mozambique were discussing the gas in Rovuma in the 70s and early 80s. And the big question they had was how to use these resources without creating a civil war in the country. Yeah? And of course, they never did it. So we discussed so much about that that they never moved forward. But the resources were there. Maybe we didn't have full information about the resources available, but they were there. And so that was the next step, was to make those resources available. And actually, it succeeded in bringing the very large capital to Mozambique. During the late Chissano's years, during the last years of Chissano as a president, not late Chissano, sorry about that, during the last years of Chissano as president, there was a movement towards bringing for, large foreign capital for big infrastructure projects, and the project in place was the Nacala Corridor. It didn't move forward that much, but that was the idea. Mozal, the big aluminium smelter, started as an accident of history, but actually then was utilized as a way to show that you can bring big capital and move big capital forward in Mozambique. Now, once you attract this capital, how do you keep it? And you have to make sure that you lower costs and you lower risks. And this was done, and while I would call the first wave of privatization as the first wave of expropriating of the state, I would call now the second wave of expropriating of the state the making of making available these resources to multinational capital at a very low cost, so much lower than market prices, and also giving extensive facilities to private capital, to this multinational capital in Mozambique. And it made sense in different ways. One, by making the resources available at very, very low cost, you would not only compensate for the costs of developing the infrastructure that was necessary to put them into operation, but above all, you could use Mozambicans as intermediaries in the process without raising the costs of the resources beyond competitive level. How? If you give a concession to a Mozambican on coal or any other thing at very, very low cost, this Mozambican can go and negotiate with a foreign investor, make a profit on it, and still the resource is very cheap for the foreign investor. So it makes the resource available. The other point was that the government had a policy to reserve 20% of shares in each of these concessions for the government, for the state. And these shares were then allocated to private entrepreneurs, not through a stock exchange mechanism, yeah, but through a system of political links and so on. And so what basically the government did was to protect one part of the projects, the company, give it to Mozambicans, make Mozambicans shareholders in that company. What was the counterpart of it? The government didn't have the finance to pay for those shares. So what they did was to give facilities to firms, like excessive fiscal incentives and things like that. There was an allocation of government infrastructure, public infrastructure, at very low cost to specific big projects. So what made sense at that period, what makes sense of it is that I'm not saying that I agree with this approach to development, I'm saying it was an approach to development that was focused on creating this national bourgeoisie, this group, a group of capitalists in Mozambique. Whether they believed that this was right for the country or not, it's irrelevant. It's not the thing that explains it. It was the argument. Whether they did it because they were crooks or not is totally unnecessary as a way of explaining the process. There was an approach to creating Mozambican capitalism under specific social and historical contexts. Now, what is the role of debt? And that is what I call this the third wave of expropriation of the state. After 25 years of stabilization and adjustment program with the IMF, the Mozambican government had created a huge debt space. So government was not allowed to contract commercial debt, foreign commercial debt, and GDP grew during that period at about 7% a year on average. So after all this time, what we had was a huge debt sustainability space. So in a way, we had created a mine that we could mine, which was the debt space. And in order to lower costs and risks, the government of Mozambique did two things. One thing was with the big areas like energy, the concessions given to multinationals were huge, really big. And this allowed multinationals to do two things. One was to sell part of the concessions, the shares in part of the concessions, to other multinationals, and in doing so, recover their costs, pay a profit to themselves, and so on. So accelerate the process of recovering that investment and therefore lowering risks and so on. But the government invested heavily also in two areas. One was infrastructure for the minerals energy complex, and another one was guaranteeing of private debt. So debt was mined to exhaustion. So the debt space was mined to exhaustion. It might have been that in the process, some people took personal advantage of that, and they were saying, I'm really pleased that the opportunity is there, so I can take personal advantage of that. It might be that in the process, people thought they were doing something important in order to create the national bourgeoisie in Mozambique. I don't know. And to be honest, I don't care very much about this element of it. I'm more interested in looking at the dynamics of it. Whether they were crooks or not, and I'm not defending that they were crooks or not defending they were not, whether they were or not, from this, the pure point of view of developing developing very fast an oligarchic group in Mozambique, it made sense historically. Of course, it had extremely high costs for the society. And this will bring me to a point that I would like to mention very briefly, is I don't think the question about right and wrong is a question to be asked in this process. Because whenever we ask that question, we don't have an answer. First, we can't decide why something is right or wrong. And second, unless we have a debate about the historical processes, and in doing so, we will need to raise the debate of class and class struggle. What is right and wrong for whom, under which conditions? Unless we do that, there is nothing that is absolutely right or absolutely wrong for the universe in general. Yeah, that's my belief. Therefore, what is right to create an oligarchic group in Mozambique might be wrong in terms of providing food, cheap food for people. But it's right in one way, it's wrong in another way. Yeah. Now, I'll go to my slides. I think you haven't said anything yet, so I assume that I have at least 5 minutes, or probably more. Right. Let me show you this slide that has a lot of information, but I'd like to call you call your attention to a few things here. One is this. So between 2000 and 2015, the Mozambican GDP trebled, grew at about 7.4% a year. Exports increased, imports of course increased as well, but the difference between the two is not that big. And we add $28 billion worth of investment, private investment. And when we look at this part of the table up to there, we are looking at an economy that looks healthy, particularly in a developing country. And at that time, we were one of the three countries in Africa more attractive for foreign direct investment, for foreign investment in general. Yeah. Then we start asking questions when you look at this part of the table. Because we see that in order to reduce poverty by 1%, Mozambique's GDP needs to grow by about 10%, 9-something%. And that is more than 3 times worse than the average in sub-Saharan Africa for countries of similar economies. It asks the question that why is our economy so inefficient at reducing poverty? So why is the elasticity of poverty reduction with respect to GDP growth so low in Mozambique when we compare it with other sub-Saharan African countries of similar economic development? If we compare it with Vietnam, it's even worse. It would be our efficiency in reducing poverty would be 5 times worse than that in Vietnam. In economic terms, it means that it's very expensive to reduce poverty in Mozambique, basically. In social terms, it means that we have problems with, maybe problems with the distribution of income and inequality and so on. But we are not sure about that. We are not sure at this point. We just need at this point to say the economy is not efficient at reducing poverty. Look at this table that shows the evolution of foreign direct investment only, real inflows in Mozambique. In 2004, the average per year was $265 million. Look at what it was in the period 2010-14. Yeah, $4 billion average per year. So Mozambique is receiving a lot of investment. When we look at private investment in Mozambique, we see that 76% come from abroad, 24% from domestic sources. But domestic sources, direct domestic investment is very low. This is the investment made by private firms, domestic private firms. It's mostly lending from the banks. While foreign investment, this is direct investment from multinational firms, and this is lending from international banks or other financial institutions. So there is no way here, it's just private investment. Yeah. So if we talk about dependency in Mozambique, the private sector dependence on foreign capital is much higher than the state dependence on it ever been. Yeah. Now, what is the point of this table? This table, sorry. Yeah, there is a point in this table. You want to understand dependency in Mozambique? Let me just show one figure in this table. This is the deposits in Mozambican banks in February this year. And look at the total deposits in savings accounts is $1.9 billion. Total deposits in savings accounts in Mozambique. So deposits in local currency plus deposits in foreign currency in Mozambique, $1.9 billion. $1.9 billion is less than what is necessary to create Mozal. Okay? It's less than that. Mozal is one company, an aluminium smelter, yeah? Which cost, Mozal 1 and 2 cost together about $2.2 billion. So the entire, this is the entire Mozambican financial, commercial financial system. So a banking system. So if we mobilize all the banks in Mozambique, we can't create one big project, right? So this starts asking questions about the development strategy. Yeah, so it's not about the crooks, it's about the development strategy. Why do we put all the eggs in this huge development of mega projects when the abilities of the economy to sustain it are low, right? It's like trying to go to space in a spaceship that can't take enough fuel, but you believe in God. Well, good riddance. Yeah. Now, the point of this table is allocation of capital. So, where did all that money go? I'm not going to go into the details of the table, we can look at that later, but the extractive core of the economy that includes minerals, energy, and commodities for exports, agrarian commodities for exports, received 75% of all private investment in Mozambique in the period 2000-2015. Yeah? 75%. The direct core, so minerals, energy, plus the agro commodities for exports. If we include the services and infrastructures that support these activities, it makes 20% more of private investment. So the extractive core of the economy received 95% of all private investment in the last 15 years. And so there is 5-6% available for the rest of the economy. Sorry, I know 95 plus 6 is 101, but this is just because of rounding numbers that we get done. And this is an image of the universe that is the Mozambican economy. We have this extractive core that includes minerals, energy, complex, plus agro commodities for export. This core includes about 20-25 companies. And they received 75% of private investment. They are responsible for 90% of all Mozambican exports. They are responsible for 50% of GDP growth rate. And they only employ 0.6% of the active population, or 7% of the formal employment in Mozambique. If we include infrastructures associated with that, then we go to the figures I showed you before. So if you don't look at Mozambican economy as independent sectors, but you try to make the links between them, that's the image you get, right? So it's a very narrow-based economy focused on some areas of development that of course will offer very narrow opportunities for development and be very inefficient at reducing poverty. Now, let me look at this, show you this table, and also quickly try to go to the main important parts of it. And there are two. One is this and one is that. Between 2006 and 15, this shows what happens to the debt issue. Why did I choose 2006? Because in 2006 was implemented the last debt restructuring in Mozambique that reduced debt stock from $6 billion to $3 billion, but half the debt stock. And was on the basis of that and the subsequent GDP growth that the debt space was created. So I'm just looking from 2006, saying this is the starting point after the last restructuring of the debt. During this period, this 9-10 years, the internal debt grew at 26%. A year on average. External debt grew at about 13% a year on average, so total debt grew at about 15% a year on average. What is the rate of growth of GDP? 7%. Right? These are official figures. So, if you have the GDP growing at 7% and debt growing at 15%, it's very easy to calculate the trajectories and see when it's going to crash. I calculated those trajectories, and it showed 2015-2016. But that's very easy. You don't need to be a soothsayer to get these figures. You can just project it and calculate it. So, this is one point. Debt increased very fast. It's not strange. The second point is that the structure of debt changed. Commercial debt grew by about 1,300%. In 2006, commercial debt was 8% of total debt, and it was only domestic commercial debt. In 2015, commercial debt is about half of total debt, and is mostly foreign debt. It's much more expensive, much more short term, and much more difficult to negotiate. In this part, I have another information, is what happened to the commercial debt? How was commercial debt spent? Well, 31% went into infrastructures. We have seen that those infrastructures are mostly focused on the minerals energy complex and agro-business for exports. 31%. 39% was guaranteeing of private loans, private debt, right? So public, the government assuming private debt. And 30% was repayment of debt. So when you get to these figures, it means that you are already engaged in a debt trap. Not discussing these issues when we discuss economic policy becomes a crime. Is there, then you can say, come on, if I didn't think you were crooks before, and I didn't need that explanation to explain the thing, now I'm starting to get doubts about you. Yeah? Now, when we discuss debt, we discuss fiscal sustainability. That's what IMF does. And IMF is very worried, has been very worried about debt in Mozambique for quite a while. But that's not the only problem with debt. Look at what the financial system in Mozambique looks like in terms of portfolios. Just think about this. We have a small economy with a small financial system, and the government is borrowing from that financial system about $350 million a year on average by selling debt bonds in that system. And the system is small, I showed you, right? What is the impact? You take liquidity out of the system, interest rates go up, and financial bonds related to government debt become a very important element in the business of finance in Mozambique. Therefore, the financial system becomes uninterested and inadequate to support small, medium enterprises and the development of a broader economy. But look at what happened between 2010 and 2014 with the portfolios of the banks. The lending to private sector as a weight, as a percentage of total lending of these banks fell by 12%. Of the productive sector, the lending to productive sector. The lending to trade as a percentage of total lending fell by 31%. But this gets interesting because lending to durable consumers, a lot of which are related to the emergence of a new bourgeoisie in Mozambique, consuming luxury houses, cars, and so on, but it's not only that, but it's related to that strongly, increased by 24%. And the business of debt, the business of government debt, increased by 23%. So the financial system has shifted to a specialized niche demand of a small, very rich national bourgeoisie, and to financial speculation at the cost of production and trade. That is directly related with the issue of debt. Yeah? Debt doesn't explain this fully, but is directly related with that. When we talk about the debt issue, it's not only sustainability. Actually, sustainability is a false question. Because what is sustainability, fiscal sustainability, is the political capacity to repress some kind of expenditure in order to give priority to other kind of expenditure. A government that can repress social spending can increase debt repayments. But that's a political issue, it's not a technical one. So fiscal sustainability is actually a political issue, it's political balance, it's class struggle, to use the words of a very good German friend of mine. But when debt affects the structures and opportunities of doing anything in the economy, then it's a different problem, because then what you have is that problem of debt just going through the entire economic spectrum and activity. Let me see if there is another. Yeah, okay, so let me just go very quickly to the points and the last points, and this is the official response to that has been a traditional, typical monetarist approach by the Mozambican authorities. It is social austerity, and social austerity in two dimensions. One is a very tight monetary policy, and another one is cut in social spending. And none of that, none of those issues actually deal with any of the problems we mentioned at all. Actually, they made it worse, make it worse. And there is a problem of efficiency. In a country where 50% of the population is poor, and 70% of the population, or 20% more, are very vulnerable, cutting social expenditure is a very, very narrow path to mobilizing savings, because there is not much that you can cut from that area. And actually pushes people into extreme poverty and so on, and so it's socially, politically unsustainable. The tight monetary policy added to that kind of structures of the financial system in Mozambique will actually prevent the financial system from operating as a tool in order to diversify the economy from that very narrow pattern of development. And so, let me go very quickly to West Ward and ask for a little bit of in a way, I'm going to owe you debt. Okay, give me some credit. That's what Joe said, that we don't exist as personalities, we just depend on the others telling us what to do, so I'm telling you. Right. So, if we want to address this problem, there is no technical way to do that. We have to confront a system of accumulation, and that is not technical, that is political. When I say political, and I'm not saying it's government, and I'm not saying it's political will. I'm saying it's political in the sense that it is related to the process how the society as such organizes itself, fights about their interests, cooperate or come into conflict, and so on. So it's political in that sense. We cannot move forward without confronting the system of accumulation we do have. The second point is that, but there are very short-term things that we need to do, or we can do. But bear in mind that short-term, that is not in the path of long-term, may actually damage long-term. So the long-term starts in the short run, and the short run that is against a long-term path will not help the process. So, for example, tight monetary policy is a short-term process that actually damages long-term prospects. So it's not a valid option. The first thing I would say in the short term is to write off the illegal debt. This is the first time I mentioned illegal debt in my presentation, because not because I think illegal debt is not important, but the debt problem in Mozambique didn't start with illegal debt. If you take the illegal debt, which is 20% of the debt stock in Mozambique, Mozambique is still have a severe debt problem. Actually, at ES, in Mozambique, we started to put this point forward before we knew there were illegal debts. Yeah? So illegal debt has political implications. Illegal debt is important, is 20% of the stock, and illegal debt is the most damaging in terms of costs and impact in financial system and so on. But the problem is not the illegal debt only. The problem is the pattern of development that is dependent on a system that is not sustainable. So write off this illegal odious debt. This is the first point. So if you do that, we write off about 20% of Mozambique's debt. Then restructure the remaining debt. We cannot pay it in the current terms. Restructure it, but in a way that it frees resources to support the process of growth and employment creation. In a way, this is not very different from what Syriza suggested, or from what the left in the Labour Party in England is suggesting, or from what the left, the Geringonza, have you heard of that? This kind of, nobody knows exactly what it is, but the kind of the government in Portugal is suggesting and implementing to some extent. The third question, which is would be related to the debt restructuring, would be to review and radically restructure the system of public investment. First, the evaluation system, and second, the priorities in public investment. So moving away from bridges that are not priorities now, and airports that don't work, and so on, and trying to diversify the economy and use the budget to help the process of diversifying and so on, rather than focus on big projects. The fourth thing would be to renegotiate the fiscal contracts, particularly with large corporations. It is estimated that if we renegotiate those contracts and we are successful, we can mobilize about $400 million a year in taxes with the situation as it is now. Now, if we do that, you remember that I said that government buys money from the domestic financial system, $350 million a year on average. If we do that with the same budget, we can stop domestic debt from growing. If you do that, you can eliminate a substantial component of the incentive of the financial system to go speculative in Mozambique, and so make the financial system more interested in financing production. And the fifth thing would be oppose social austerity, both monetary and fiscal. Now, there is a caveat, and I'm going to go to this point here. What I said so far is clarifying questions and problems, understanding how the specific economy works, redefining priorities, finding the options available, and so on. Yeah? The question is, none of this is a non-political issue. None of this is a an issue without tension and conflict. How the economy works, we have tensions about that. And it's not only because we have different schools of thought, it's because there are different interests being promoted through different ways of looking at the economy. How do we define priorities? What would the priority be for a large capital or for workers? I can give you an example. Industrial capital in Mozambique, the big groups in Mozambique, are pushing for the priority of the government to be to develop downstream linkages out of the mega mineral and energy projects. That means developing chemical industry and so on and so forth out of the gas, iron and steel, out of coal and so on. If you do that, you will spend the same amounts of money, so you are going to have this impossible debt situation without creating jobs, without feeding the economy, and so on. So it does solve the problem of expanding profit, large profit opportunities. It doesn't solve the problem of poverty, inequality, job creation, broad-based development, and so on. Yet, can you say that is not a priority with sense? It makes sense from a point of view. It makes sense from a certain group of interests, not from other groups of interests. So, whatever I said about options, need to be contextualized in one point, which is what is the articulation, mobilization, organization, action of the society as a whole in fighting about the options, the ways, and so on, to go about the development of Mozambique in a different or a similar approach. Neoliberal economics talks about the big problem of capturing the state. The state is captured by vested interests, and so the state shouldn't be in the economy, and so on. I actually think that the main task of the working class is to capture the state, as capitalism has done. And capturing the state doesn't mean making a state that is authoritarian, dictatorship, and so on. Means developing the capacity to actually influence in a manner that is important, that is significant, that makes sense, influences the policy process to the last conclusions, the conclusions of deciding what to do, implementing it, correcting it, and so on. And the state is not the only participant in the process, because what goes through states and markets are the relationships, conflicts, and tensions between the different groups in society. Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for your credit.
Well, a revolutionary statement today at the end. May I please ask
you? We need to have lunch at some time.
Yeah. Yes, but we certainly need to listen to a little account.
I think what I have to say can may make up for lunch. I don't think so. So thank you very much, Kavchinonu, for a very good presentation. I just want to go on the record here, having said that I think Kavchinonu has got probably one of the best descriptions of the workings of the Mozambican economy. I mean, I've said this in the past, and I think I need to say that. It's one of the best descriptions of the Mozambican economy, and I also think that it gives us a very good framework to start thinking about what to do about the problems which this economy has. I don't think he gives us those. I think he gives us a good description. I don't think the options that he sees particularly relevant, unless if we introduce some limitations, and then I think we will go into a very interesting conversation. So what I want to do is precisely to kick off that conversation. But before I do that, I mean, I'll basically do two things. I'll give you a summary of what I understood, and I think it's important that I do that because this bears then on some of the issues I want to raise. And before I do that, I want to come back to something which he kept repeating and which came up in the discussion before, which concerns, whether we should think about crooks or well-meaning people and so on. I really do think that's important from an analytical point of view. Maybe here we have different scientific or scholarly cultures, right? If you want to make a case and you want to protect that case, then of course you will only look for things which confirm that case. And then you're not interested in asking further questions which may undermine that case. So if you ask, were the colonialists well-meaning, you're not saying that, you want to get them off the hook. You want to put your account to the test. You want to see if the account which you're making holds water and in a consistent way. That's the whole point of it. And interestingly enough, when Kavchinonu then comes on to talk about the alternative, it comes back to those issues, and I think that's very important, right? I mean, if you can save, you know, if you can collect $400 million dollars a year, once you have done certain things which are which should be done, right? What are you saying? You are saying, well, I mean, why did these crooks not do that before? I mean, why do you expect them to do that afterwards if you do not raise that question? So I think that's important, and maybe this is, if you like, an issue that that has to do with semantics, because I think, you know, judging from what he said at the end, we are speaking the same language here. So his point is the following, that the crisis that we have now is actually, if you like, it's basically showing the limitations of what he calls dependent capitalism, right? And the background to that is, of course, the idea that, you know, you have a situation which is prior to launching Mozambique into this capitalist road, or of an underdeveloped national bourgeoisie, actually of even a lack of support for that before, which undermined that process, of course. And then you have a whole context of structural adjustment programs, which is thought to be the vehicle through which you are going to create this kind of capitalism, by basically unleashing the private sector, and then of course this whole process in the context of Mozambique has to be done through what I think he convincingly showed, through the expropriation of the state, basically. And I think that's a very important point that he's making. And of course, the reasoning behind that is that, you know, if you want to create capitalism in a country like Mozambique under those circumstances, you are probably likely to create a situation where that country and that country's economy will be vulnerable to crisis. And I think his discussion of the debt crisis, and I agree with him completely on that issue, that the debt crisis, the real debt crisis, is actually prior to what actually brought us together here. And a lot of people have been saying that for many years, I think last year, have been saying that for many years, have been warning us against the alarming proportions that this thing is taking. So why does a country become vulnerable to crisis under the conditions of dependent capitalism? Well, because of the nature of the arrangements which need to be made, which of course may lead to highly problematic situations. We don't need to call them corruption for the time being, but that's basically what is likely to happen. Of course, what he says, that you know, there is a logic behind capitalism which is not necessarily concerned with meeting basic needs, but with making profits, and making profits in ways that may undermine livelihoods. And then, of course, I mean, the massive attack which is launched on the, you know, social policy, and so on, and so on. So I think this is again a very convincing case for the vulnerability of dependent capitalism. In fact, I would say it's almost circular to talk about debt or about crisis and dependent capitalism, because I think from the case which he made, well, dependent capitalism is crisis, basically, right? So it's actually redundant in a certain way. Now, there are two issues I want to raise for the discussion here. The first issue is simply, if you like, a logical issue. And maybe it's easy to solve that issue. You know, I think there's a difference between saying dependent capitalism is always crisis, or dependent capitalism under certain circumstances can produce crisis. Now, if you agree with me that there's a difference between those two statements, then you'll have to acknowledge that then, at that moment, when you are giving this description of dependent capitalism, you need to ask questions about crooks, about good and right, and also about well-meaning or not well-meaning, right? Because those are the questions that that we need to ask, because those are, you know, what, by his own account, you know, those are the political issues, you know. We don't have to go all the way to political economy, but those are the political issues that need to be raised. And so I think, yes, we need to raise these issues, and I'm really interested in knowing, especially from him, who's got a long history of being committed to these discussions in Mozambique, participating in them, really to give us an account of why it is that certain forms of capitalism or certain forms of thinking about economic decisions in Mozambique, you know, won as opposed to other forms. Why is it that those people were able to assert themselves? Why was it that the political discussion that would have been necessary did not take place? Why is it that people were blind, were ignorant, perhaps even of the other issues that had to be raised? So that's the first issue which I think we need to raise. The second issue that we need to raise, and this is for me a very difficult one, and it has also to do with the first presentation, and I already anticipated this, and I asked the question, because you see, there are two ways of reacting to this, especially if you are consistent about not talking about crooks, right? So you can say, one thing you can say is the following, you know, if you are under the condition of dependent capitalism, you are basically, the word is F up, right? There's no way, you know, you are done, right? And so the option then perhaps is revolution or delinking and so on and so on. But there's no longer any way in which you can talk about these issues, right? About alternatives within that particular thing. But the other option is to say, oh yes, of course there are alternatives, right? And this is what he suggested. Even though he constructed his presentation by focusing actually on the overwhelming power of dependent capitalism, right? And I think what he suggested, which is not in line with what he described, I think it's much more useful, right? And it takes us back again to the questions about crooks, right? Because it is about the nature of the political system, the nature of the political society, and the nature and quality of debate within a particular polity that makes it possible or not possible for people to take certain decisions or not take decisions, and so on. So yes, in that sense, I think, yeah, we are not only dealing with an economic issue, and perhaps it's not even an economic issue that we are dealing with. We are dealing with the nature of the Mozambican political system. So what is the problem with the political system in Mozambique? So that's it.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for Elisa Macabre for insightful comments. They compensate a little bit for our lunch, which gets shorter and shorter. And yes, I think we have somehow
a real problem in the sense that we, I think, should start again at 2 o'clock. We are quite over time, shall we?
10 past 1.
Yeah.
Shall we make it? Also to be given a chance.
Yes, of course. Yeah. But can we still take a round and maybe one round of questions? No, very short questions. No questions.
Yeah. Just
shall I say something?
Yes.
What do you want to do then? Is there a possibility that we take some questions after lunch? Is it possible?
This is the most important part of the discussion.
Well, that's
a bit more important than that. But what we could do is collect questions and take them up in the final panel.
Oh, right.
Because I think some people physically need lunch in order to be able to sustain them through the day. And at lunch we can continue also to
act. Why can't we take 15 minutes to take questions and answers? I mean, I think this is the key presentation for this
session. But I mean, if people are ready to go for fast food somewhere at the shop.
Mm-hmm. No, we have organized.
Oh, we have organized.
Yeah. Well, we can always take questions in the afternoon. I'm easy with that. I don't mind. It depends on you. I don't physically need lunch. I have quite a lot of desserts. but the other people do. So, I don't want to be crooked.
So
in that case,
so let's, in that case,
shall I just briefly answer the questions that you raised or not?
Yes, I would think so. Yeah,
and then take questions. Okay, sure. About the first question, my argument is that capitalism is a crisis, and actually the argument goes like that: the crisis is the pulsating system of capitalism. Capitalism is continued to exist because of the ability to create crises and come out of it. And that is true also for late capitalism like in Mozambique. The question is that we have conditions that are different from the capitalism that controls finance and so on. We don't. And so we have conditions that are different. But so in saying that, I would say it's not that under certain circumstances we create crises, is that if we don't, capitalism cannot not create crises. And this is related with the process of accumulation. Capital cannot not accumulate continuously over and over again. And this will create the crisis of capitalism. In our situations is worse than that because of the patterns of production, very narrow patterns of production and so on, that makes us particularly vulnerable. And one of the dynamics that is there is what is in some literature called the past dependency dynamics, which is what? So we want to finance change. Yeah, we want to create a different productive base in the country. Where are we going to get the finance from? So we need to produce foreign exchange in order to sustain the imports that are necessary to broaden the base of production. Where is the foreign exchange going to come from? Either going to come from financial markets or is going to come from the export base. What is our export base? The export base is primary products that are very volatile and so on and so forth. So what do? You invest in that export base in order to create the base for exports that will finance a change. When you do that, you expose yourself even more to the volatility of the international market. So there are lots of things like that in the past dependency of dependent capitalism. I'm not saying that it's like that every time or it's like that in every country, but there are these particularities. But the argument is that the crisis is an organic part of capitalism because it's part of the readjustment, the cleaning, and so on of the system. When accumulation reaches
certain levels, and this is also necessary to bring about the rate of profits and so on. And it has been the ability of capitalism to renew itself through the crisis that has enabled capitalism to actually innovate and move forward and so on. Of course, at high social costs. So the question is, that goes back to the last point, is the nature of society that resists to that kind of solutions and is able to organize themselves and so on. When that happens, if you happen to be able to resist to the austerity and so on and so forth, you may actually bring about fundamental change. It can put capitalism in a different path altogether, for example, the social state, or it can actually move beyond capitalism, which hasn't yet happened yet, but I still pretty sure it's going to happen at some point. At least I'm pretty sure that I wish it's going to happen at some point. So that's the first point. This, the last point about the solution. I know that what I suggested is not detached, but is looking at one point of entry in the system. So I'm not saying the solution for the system is this other system, because I actually don't believe in it. I don't believe in a systemic solution of the capitalist problem in the case of Mozambique. But what I'm trying to look at is entry points for short-term alternatives to austerity that will make the things worse. And if the things get worse, it's not because these people are stupid, incompetent, or crooks. It's because that's one approach to the system that is embedded in the system. So I'm looking for an alternative to it, which is not particularly innovative because it's there in the literature to be discussed. And it's an entry point looking at, okay, if the resulting process is the process resulted in this particular manifestation of crisis, what can you do that allows the economy to reignite and move forward and create an opportunity for change that is not detached from a long-term path of fundamental change? And that's why, for example, I focused on trying to stop domestic debt from growing. I'm not saying that that's the solution, and I'm not saying that's easy. I'm just saying if you do that, and this is a point of options, if you do that, you can actually change fundamental things in the working of the financial system and move resources away from this enclave, a mega economy, to support the development of other parts of the economy. Just to give you a last example, in the last mandate of President Guebuz, in the last 5 years, the government approved a package for the Ministry of Industry and Trade to support small and medium companies, and the package was worth $5 million for 5 years. Yeah? If you tax Mozal at the normal tax rate, only the taxes that are redundant, I'm just talking about redundant incentives, redundant tax incentives. If you tax Mozal, eliminate the redundant incentives and you tax Mozal, you can mobilize $128 million a year, which is several times more than the package for small and medium companies for 5 years. Elysio likes the district funding. Yeah, so you can finance the district funding with Mozal, not needing donors at all. Yeah, so these are entry points if you think of them. Now, taxing Mozal is a political issue, it's a class related issue, and so on. So it's a political issue. It's not just one guy is cleverer than another guy. That is not the point. Yeah.
Good. Thank you.